James chapter 1, beginning in verse 18. For to those who are perishing, the message of the cross is foolishness. But to us who are being saved, it is God's power. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will set aside the understanding of the experts. Where is the philosopher? Where is the scholar? Where is the debater of this age? Hasn't God made the world's wisdom foolish? For since in God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom, God was pleased to save those who believed through the foolishness of the message preached. For the Jews ask for signs, and the Greeks seek wisdom, but we preach Christ crucified, a stumbling block to Jews and foolishness to the Gentiles. Yet to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is God's power and God's wisdom. Because God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Brothers, consider your calling. Not many are wise from a human perspective. Not many powerful, not many of noble birth. Instead, God has chosen the world's foolish things to shame the wise. God has chosen the world's weak things to shame the strong. God has chosen the world's insignificant and despised things, the things viewed as nothing, so he might bring to nothing the things that are viewed as something. So that no one can boast in his presence. For from him you are in Christ Jesus, who for us became the wisdom from God, as well as righteousness, sanctification, and redemption, in order that as it is written, the one who boasts must boast in the Lord. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time you've given to us. We pray right now as we dig into your word, as we learn about what you view as being wise, what you view as being true wisdom, and what you tell us is foolishness, Father. Lord, we pray that you will help us to understand who you are, to understand the wisdom that you give, and that we'll understand how foolish it is to disagree with you, how foolish it is to trust in anything else as our source of wisdom. Lord, guide us through this time. Help us to dig in your word. Help us to understand what you would have us to learn this morning. We love you and we ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Like I said, we're going to get to the video clip. That's going to deal a large part with our definitions of wisdom and foolishness. But first, we need to remember to examine the context of this letter. This is a letter written to a church in the city of Corinth. Many books of the Bible, when you read the context and you read what they're talking about, they're a general nature. That doesn't mean they don't deal with deep topics, but it means that for all people of all time. Okay, if you read the book of Ephesians, it's very much, it doesn't matter if you were the church of Corinth, the church of Ephesus, the church of, any other city. It applied equally to everybody. It was strictly theological. The letter of Corinth is not that. It is a very specific letter. It's a very personal letter. Paul is writing to the church of Corinth, and he's explaining intimate details of what's going on at their church. And the reason Paul wrote this was because he had heard, he had a messenger come, it says, from a member of Chloe's household, who came and said, Paul, there are problems at the church of Corinth. The church of Corinth is divided. They're broken up into different factions. They have all these different groups. There's some people in the church who are saying, well, I follow Paul. Other people are saying, well, I follow Cephas or Peter. Another one is saying, I follow Apollos. There's still a whole other group that's saying, I follow Christ. And when Paul hears this, he's troubled by it. Just listed right there, the church is divided up into four different groups. And so Paul writes primarily the letter, this whole letter, to help them, honestly, to help them to get along. To teach them how to live together and how to worship together. It says the body of Christ should not be divided, but it needs to be united in Christ. And he hits several different troubled areas. One we're going to talk about right now is wisdom. He explains to them the different views of wisdom. And their culture, like ours, they had a hierarchy of wisdom. And I think we're the same way. We struggle. We have the people who we look up to and say, listen, that person, they're just so wise. They're so smart. They're so intelligent. They always say the right thing. They always do the right thing. And then there's people on the other side of the spectrum. There's people like, you know, they're the ones who are driving. It's like, oh, that idiot, what are they doing? Okay? They say something online or they, now there's a whole bunch of joke on Facebook, and I'm not going to get too far into it, but there are some people that just post these incredibly stupid things on there. It's like, hey, you know the lie scam? You're not in it. You're on the far other end. And so we do have this hierarchy of the people that we think are wise and the people that we think are foolish, okay? And most of us think we're in the wise camp, okay? Notice the foolish people do too. But we have this idea of a hierarchy of wisdom. And so did the people in Corinth, and that was one of their dividing factors, okay? They had one of these things where some people thought they were really high up and really had this intense wisdom. I just remember when I went to college, we had some amazingly qualified professors over at North Greenville. But I remember the smartest ones came up to you and just said, hey, the chairman of religion, Walter Johnson, walk up and say, hey, I'm Walter Johnson. And then some of the other ones, you'd walk up to him and you'd say, hey, Mr. So-and-so, and they'd say, Doctor. Okay? Don't miss that. I worked hard to get that. I'm a doctor. And they felt like they had to compensate. Okay? So we have this idea of wisdom where we try to get up towards the top of it and we think our own ideas are wiser than other people's. And that's natural. Okay? It's honestly natural. People say, if I tell them why I'm a Baptist, and they say, well, you just think Baptists are more right than anybody else. Yeah! Of course I do. If I thought someone else was more right than a Baptist, I'd be that. Okay? But at the same time, again, I'm not preaching against other denominations. I'm just saying we think that our own view is right. We trust in our own view of wisdom and knowledge. And this has become a divine factor for the people at Corinth. And so Paul takes this time to help explain to them both what his view or what the biblical view of wisdom is, and also compares it to the worldly view of wisdom. For to those who are perishing, verse 18, the message of the cross is foolishness. We just saw a great example of that, okay? Two people, both staunch atheists, I think Bill Mayer actually considers himself an agnostic. So we have an atheist and an agnostic who are pretty much making fun of Christianity. Do you realize how foolish it is that people actually believe this stuff? And they even contradict that, well, these wise, smart people, how crazy it is that these smart scientists believe in a talking snake. And so they've written it off. Hey, I think this is dumb, therefore it's dumb. What are these people thinking? And Paul says that's exactly the way it is. The message of the cross is foolishness to those who are perishing, but to us who are being saved, it is God's power. For it is written, I'll destroy the wisdom of the wise, I'll set aside the understanding of the experts. I want to clarify one thing before we get too deep in here. I am not anti-science. We're going to come back to that a little bit later. I don't believe we'll just throw out all that science junk and we just need to blindly follow the Bible, okay? I think that's ridiculous, and I think so many people have created this war that doesn't exist between science and the Bible, okay? That's not where I'm going with this, so please stay with me. What I am saying is, so many times we trust in our own personal ideas and philosophies and wisdom and reject God's. And here, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise. I will set aside the understanding of the experts. He's quoting Isaiah 29:14, where God says, all these wise people, the people that you consider wise from a worldly standpoint, I'm going to put that to the side, because they don't even compare to the wisdom that I have. It sounds very much, especially coming up, it's very much the way that God spoke to Job in the book of Job. At the very end where Job keeps asking questions, let God stand before me, let him explain his ways to me. And finally God comes to him in the form of a whirlwind, and he says, Job, where were you when I created the world? Can you tell me how I did it? All these animals that I created, hey, you remember that, Job? Because you were there, weren't you? You remember when I created the ocean and I told it could only come this far before it turns to the beach? You remember when I had that conversation with the ocean, Job? Because Job, you don't remember that. And Job was at least wise enough. He says one thing, that conversation where God's talking goes on for about 3 chapters. And Job has one line. He says, I don't remember exactly how he says it. Ultimately, I have spoken foolishly, I'll be quiet now. And God continues. Job, where were you? You think you're so wise. You think you're so guy and have him come talk to me, and we'll see how it goes. Where is this debater with all this knowledge? Where is this philosopher who's got it all figured out? Let him come forward and explain it. Hasn't God made the world's wisdom foolish? For since in God's wisdom, the world did not know God through wisdom, God was pleased to save those who believed through the foolishness of the message preached. He's being facetious here, okay? If you read any of Paul's scripture, I don't know of any other time where he describes the gospel as foolish, okay? He doesn't think that the gospel is dumb or foolish. He doesn't think it's unwise, but he's talking from this worldly standpoint. People like Richard Dawkins and Bill Mayer, who think that the Bible is foolish. They've labeled it that way. They've decided this is how it is because they're so smart they can make that decision. He says, hasn't the world considered it to be foolish? But hasn't God made the world's wisdom to be foolish? All these people who think they have it so figured out. I get entertained by people who say, I don't trust the Bible, I trust science. And I can't help but wonder, you take the smartest person on the planet, who trusts in science, how much science do you think he knows? Do you think he knows it all? Do you think he's got it all figured out? He has so much book smarts? No, he doesn't. He doesn't have a fraction of the science figured out. And there are people all throughout the ages. No, we learn more about the world in our sixth grade biology class than people knew hundreds of years ago. And there were still people saying, hey, I trust science. You don't even know science. You don't have it all figured out. God says, I'm going to take the wisest wisdom, the greatest amount of wisdom, and I'm going to toss it aside. For since in God's wisdom the world did not know God through wisdom, God was pleased to save those who believed through the foolishness of the message preached. That foolishness he's talking about is the gospel. One of the things I told him the other service too, I might not have a job after this sermon. because of what I'm about to say. I think a lot of times, especially those of us who grew up in church, we don't understand how crazy the gospel is. Honestly, think about it. We really don't have any idea how crazy the gospel is. The fact that we've broken God's law, we're a sinner, we've received the death penalty, we deserve judgment and hell for all eternity, but God loved us so much, even while we were his enemies, that he sent his son to die on the cross so that you could be saved. And he did that knowing, one, that you would continue to sin against him, you'd continue to violate his laws, and two, knowing that a huge portion of the population would still never accept him, would still never worship him. If I'm in his position, there's no choice. That's crazy. But it shows how much God loves us, how much he cares about us, that he would make that sacrifice for us. But yeah, I get how from Richard Dawkins or Bill Mayer or a dozen other people, I get how they have a hard time believing that. I get how that's difficult to understand. The saying goes, if it's too good to be true, it probably is. And 99% of the time, that's right. You know? Especially on credit card statements, by the way. Okay? If you read it in those advertisements or something in the mail, that's too good to be true. It is. Okay? But when it comes to God, and he makes this promise, and he shows his love to us, and we're like, that is just crazy. That is ridiculous. I can't believe that God would love us so much that he would make that sacrifice. So again, how people have a hard time with that, but God says through the foolishness of the message preached, he brought salvation. For the Jews ask for signs, and the Greeks seek wisdom. There he's talking cultural. Back then when Jesus was walking throughout Nazareth and Galilee, walking through all those areas, and he had this massive following of thousands upon thousands of people. You know who the vast majority of them were? Jews. They were Jews who wanted to believe that Jesus was the Messiah. But you know what they did? They kept following Jesus and said, Jesus, what sign will you give us to prove what you're saying is true? And Jesus performed plenty of signs. Pastor just finished a series on the seven signs in the book of John. So Jesus was not without signs. He didn't say, just trust me. Well, one time when they came and they said, Jesus, What sign will you give us? Since Moses gave us bread in the wilderness. What sign will you give us? That was the idea throughout the Old Testament. When anyone claimed to speak on God's behalf, they said, well, what sign do you have to prove it? You remember Moses? Remember the first sign that he performed? His staff in front of Pharaoh. And he threw it down before Pharaoh and turned into a snake. Then he continued through the plagues of Egypt. Hailstorms killing livestock. The river Nile turned to blood. By the way, doesn't it say it turned like blood? The river Nile turned to blood. All the water in Egypt turned to blood. Frogs everywhere. Locusts destroying crops. Boils breaking out of people's skin. I think those are some pretty good signs. Okay, I'm thinking you can't really doubt that Moses has some hidden power that we don't know about. And he claimed that that power is God, is Yahweh. And then when he got into the wilderness, remember he opened the Red Sea by the power of God, you didn't know. By the power of God, he's part of the Red Sea. The Israelites went through, closed the Red Sea, destroyed the armies. The people of Israel are singing praises to God and to Moses' servant. And they go through the wilderness, it doesn't take long before they start to get hungry. And they say, Moses, why have you let us out here? You lead us out here to starve? We're better off in Egypt. And Moses prays to God. And as a sign, God provides for the people of Israel. He sends manna. They wake up in the morning, the ground is covered with all these little white flakes. And it's like a bread-like substance. Well, we don't know what it is. The Israelites don't know what it is. They call that manna. You know what manna means? What is it? They literally called it, what is it? Now we call it a thingamajig, or whatchamacallit. They called it, what is it? And they ate. You know how many Israelites there were? They estimate about 2 million. It's a lot of little white flakes. But God did. And so now the Israelites are calling Jesus on and saying, Moses gave our ancestors manna in the desert. What sign will you give, Jesus? You going to top that? Jesus says, a wicked and adulterous generation asks for a sign, but none will be given to it except for the sign of Jonah. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the whale, so the Son of Man will be 3 days and 3 nights in the belly of the earth. This is the sign that you get is when I die. When I die for the sins of the world and rise from the dead, that's all the sign that you're going to need. But the Jews continually were searching for signs, and even today, okay, there's a group of the Jewish faith called Messianic Jews that do believe in Jesus, but the vast majority, if they still believe the Messiah is coming, they don't believe it's Jesus. They're still waiting. Many of the Jews have just given up on it. They don't even believe in it anymore. They're searching for signs. The Greeks at that time, they were different. Many of you have ever studied Greek mythology. They search for wisdom. That's our key word for the morning. They search for wisdom. Jews search for signs. Greeks search for wisdom. Their culture was one that they sat around and they talked about things and they thought through things. If you remember the story of Paul when he was traveling in the book of Acts, he goes to a place called Athens. And when he gets to Athens, the people there, you know, some people are farmers, some people are different types of workers, the people in this area in Athens, you know what they did? They sat around and they talked. We talked about the weather, they talked about philosophies, different viewpoints, and they sat and they just bounced philosophies and different ideas off of each other. If you ever taken a class in philosophy, it comes from two different words, great words. The first is phileo. It's where we get the city Philadelphia from. It means love. So the second word is sophia. It means wisdom. Philosophy is a love of wisdom. And so when people come up with these different philosophies, it's because of their love for wisdom that they're searching for some type of meaning. In Athens, in Greek culture, that's what they did. They searched for all these different types of wisdom to try and figure out God, to try and figure out the world. And God explains they're searching for wisdom, but we don't give the Jews signs. We don't give the Greeks wisdom. You know what we preach? Christ crucified. We don't give them signs. We don't give them wisdom. We preach Christ crucified. He's a stumbling block for the Jews. Think about that. The Jewish faith is still struggling with them. They don't believe that their Messiah was supposed to die. He was studying, you know, the Old Testament scriptures and what the Jews thought the Messiah would look like. He was going to ride in on a white horse and save the day and single-handedly, you know, cause a revolt against the Romans, defeat the Romans, and was going to restore Israel to the glory that it had before. Jesus didn't come like that. They certainly didn't expect a baby in a manger, born of a woman out of wedlock, living the Accord life, leading a little ragtag group of disciples. That's not how they pictured the Messiah. And so the fact that Jesus came, and more so the fact that he died, that's a stumbling block for the Jewish faith. A stumbling block to the Jews, and a foolishness to the Gentiles. Jesus didn't light up with the philosophies of the Greek people. You know, they had this idea where they had all these altars, and the philosophy in Athens was, we'll just build altars to all the gods, and that way we won't offend any of them, that way they won't decide to smite us. And so they had all these different altars, all these different gods, and then they had one altar that they put on there to an unknown god. And the idea was, well, just in case we missed one, that random god that we don't know about won't bring judgment on us. It's very Greek mythology, very Zeus, I'm going to smite you with a lightning bolt to get on my nerves. But that's the idea. That's how the Greeks viewed things, and Jesus didn't line up with it. You think about the Greek gods, not that any of them actually exist. They were either beautiful or strong. Okay? There's a hierarchy of the gods that were fighting and deceiving and manipulating, you know, these gods who were having babies and doing all this other kind of stuff. And Jesus didn't line up with what the Greeks viewed about religion and philosophy and gods. So Jesus' death is a stumbling block to the Jews. It's foolishness to the Gentiles. Yet to those who are called, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is God's power and God's wisdom. So here we're separating. Says Jesus, honestly, he doesn't line up with the worldly view of wisdom. He doesn't line up with what most people think of wisdom. We see that in our video, and there's millions more out on YouTube if you want to see them. He doesn't line up with what most of the world thinks should be. Jesus Christ is God's power and God's wisdom. Because God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom. And God's weakness is stronger than human strength. Because we're not even in the same ballpark with God. We're not even there. He said before, bring out the debater, bring out the philosopher. Do I think that I can stand up before God and say, God, I don't really like how you did things here. No, I think you should have tweaked it a little bit more. If it were me, I would have done it a little bit differently. And by the way, you guys are awfully lucky it's not me. Okay? Because things would be different. And I'm pretty sure it would be good. Because God's wisdom is so much higher than mine. God's strength is so much stronger than mine. Just the foolishness of God is wiser than my greatest wisdom. Remember, Paul doesn't think that any part of God is foolish. Okay? He's being facetious. He's talking in their terms. God's foolishness is stronger than you. We use the same kind of terminology, you know? That person can take you with one hand tied behind his back. You know? We're talking about smart people and getting to college with these brilliant professors. Someone come to me and say, that person, he's forgotten more than you'll ever know. And so we put these people on pedestals. And that's what Paul is doing to God. God's wisdom doesn't even compare to yours. You fall so far short of even comprehending how wise and strong and mighty God is. God's foolishness is wiser than human wisdom, and God's weakness is stronger than human strength. And then he makes a person. Brothers, consider your calling. Not many are wise from a human perspective, not many powerful, not many of noble birth. Instead, God has chosen the world's foolish things to shame the wise. And God has chosen the world's weak things to shame the strong. And God has chosen the world's insignificant and despised things, the things viewed as nothing, so he might bring to nothing the things viewed as something, so that no one can boast in his presence. But from him you are in Christ Jesus, who've rescued wisdom from God, as well as righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. In order that as it is written, the one who boasts should boast in the Lord. He says, look at yourselves. You're not wise. You're not a noble bird. If you would have learned and create the ideal church, you wouldn't be a part of it. But God chose you. Jesus, when he was traveling around, he was followed by what most people would consider to be the rejects of society. His closest group were stupid fishermen, an evil tax collector who robbed his own people, a zealot who was continually at war, trying to turn people against the Roman government and overthrow them. That is not who we would pick to be our followers. That's not who any rabbi that ever existed would pick to be their followers. But Jesus chose the poor, chose the ones who people looked down upon. He spent his time with prostitutes, with the sexually immoral, with the tax collectors, with the sinners. He spent his time with lepers, with people that other people wouldn't even touch. He spent his time with little children. Remember, even the disciples, they got a little bit arrogant following Jesus. So they say, no, keep those children back. Pretty much, Jesus is busy right now. Jesus said, no, let the little children come to me. Those are the people that Jesus chose to spend his time with. He chose to spend his time with the weak, with the foolish, and he chose to use them for his glory. You remember, that's the same way it is in every Old Testament story. Jesus very rarely uses the qualified person. In Israel's time, when Israel started asking for a king, and God said, fine, Samuel, give them a king, and they pick out the ideal king. It was Saul. And Saul, it doesn't tell us much about him. He told us that he was rugged and he was handsome, so he stood a head taller than anybody else. And it was everybody else in Israel came up to his shoulder. Crowd of people, you see Saul, because he's a king. That's the kind of stuff that kings are made out of. And Saul was a terrible king. God used him mightily, and then he got arrogant. Saul thought he could break the rules. Saul thought he was, a good person for God to have on his team. And he sinned. And then God comes to Samuel and he says, Saul sinned. I'm going to take the kingdom away from him. I'm going to give it to someone who's a man after my own heart. So Samuel goes, he meets up with Jesse's family. God tells him it's going to be one of Jesse's children. And Jesse parades his children in front of Samuel. And the first one comes, and Samuel's like, God, hey, this guy, this is a king. He looks like a king. He acts like a king. This is the one. And Samuel says, no, Samuel. He might look good from the outside, but man looks at the outward appearance. I look at the heart. And one by one, Jesse brings his children through. And each time, God says, Samuel, this isn't it. And finally, all the children of God, and Samuel says, there's nobody left. He asks Jesse, says, is this all your children? And Jesse says, well, I do have the youngest. He's not here. He's out in the field tending to the sheep. They didn't even bother bringing David in. When David came in, God said, this is the man after my own heart. He chose the weak little boy. And raised him up to be one of the greatest kings Israel would ever have. Remember the story of Gideon, where Gideon is about to free the people of Israel. He's going to war to free Israel from their oppressors. And God says, Gideon, you're a little bit outnumbered. Your arm is too big. Cut it down. And Gideon does. He sends the majority of them home. It says, Gideon, you're pretty outnumbered. Your arm is too big. You know who gets the credit if you win this battle? You do. They'll say, whoa, look at Gideon. He's a mighty war hero. God says, your arm is still too big. Gideon sends the majority of them home. He's left with a tiny little group, about 300. And God says, Gideon, you know who gets the credit if you win now? It's a suicide march. You're walking near death. When you win, do you know who gets the credit? I do. God uses the weak things. He uses the foolish things. He uses the things that are not to nullify the things that are. That's how God works. He gets the credit for it, not us. And that's why he ends with that anyone who boasts should boast the Lord. You know, a lot of our division comes from boasting. It comes from thinking of ourselves higher than we ought to. I think I deserve something. I think I'm smarter than someone. I think I'm better than someone. And they need to recognize it, or we're going to have division. That's the idea. Paul says, no. There's no boasting in the kingdom of God. Because when your wisdom doesn't come from your own mind, when your strength doesn't come from your own body, but you as a church take it from God, there's no boasting. Well, he who boasts, boasts in the Lord. One more thing before we quit, because I really don't want to be misunderstood here. I mentioned that earlier. I do not believe Paul's point is stop studying, stop learning, just trust God. I don't believe in blind faith. It's a very un-Christian thing to say. I don't believe in blind faith. I don't find it in the Bible. Why is it blind faith? I don't believe in blind faith. I don't find it in the Bible anywhere. If you find it, let me know. There are plenty of places where God tells his people to trust him. It's always based on what God has done in the past. When God says, Israel, you need to trust me, I'm the God of your ancestors. I'm the God who took care of Abraham. I'm the God who took care of Isaac. I'm the God who took care of Jacob. I'm the God who freed Israel with a mighty hand from the land of Egypt. That's why you should trust me. I'm the one who fed you in the desert with food, with manna, later with quail. I'm the one who provided water from the rock so you didn't die of starvation. I'm the one who led you into the promised land and helped you conquer these people. This is why you should trust me, because I proved myself faithful in the past. I don't believe that God anywhere tells us to honor him because of blind faith. Trust me, because I'm God. What God does do is he says, look at it, evaluate it. The Bible says that the heavens declare the glory of God. The skies proclaim the work of his hands. Day after day they pour forth speech. Night after night they display knowledge. There's no speech or language where their voice is not heard. Their word echoes into the world. When you look at the sky, when you look at creation, when you look at science, it testifies that there is an awesome, almighty, loving God. So many times people like Richard Dawkins and other atheists have taken science and misconstrued it to say, no, this proves that there's no God. 20 years ago, the main atheist argument was, well, Jesus is a myth, like Zeus, like any of those other ones. He's a myth. He never existed. None of them hold that position anymore because they found archaeological evidence that Jesus walked. There are very few. Okay, there's some crazy ones, okay? But there are very few qualified atheists who deny that Jesus walked anymore. Archaeological evidence has proven it. Science supports the Bible. It always has. And it always will. And that's why we as Christians, we can't just say, no, I trust the Bible. Well, why? Because my mom did. Because her mom did. Because her mom did. Because her mom did. I'm a 12th generation Christian. It's great that you have that family legacy. But why do you trust the Bible? You need to have a stronger answer. That's not going to convince people who are skeptical of the Bible. I don't believe that God calls us to ignorance. Chip Ingram preached a series and called it, you don't have to throw your brains out the window to be a Christian. When you study scripture, when you study the Bible, when you study science, when you study chemistry, when you study archaeology, when you do all these studies, you find continuing testimony that there is a God. You know what? I'll never know, without a doubt, every single thing there is to know. I can't go on stage and publicly debate Richard Dawkins. I don't know our science for that. And ultimately, our science falls short because we don't understand it all. And that's where we take our own man-made philosophies, and we set them aside, and we trust God. The God who has been faithful in the past. The God who has continually proven himself to be real through the scriptures and through science. The God who has continued to work throughout the world. You know what? I can take the faith in God and apply it to those areas that I don't understand. We take our own philosophies and we put them on the side. We keep searching, we keep digging, we keep studying, because they testify to God. The more we learn about science, the more we learn about God's creation. Yeah. And that's an awesome thing. So I'm certainly not saying just toss that stuff aside. I don't believe in the war between science and religion. I believe that science is religion's closest ally. I believe that science continually supports the Bible. But ultimately, we need to be willing to take our own ideas and our own mindsets and our own philosophies and put them in the science of God. Like Job, I don't know. I don't understand. But I trust in you. I place my faith in you. As we get ready for our invitation, as we go to the Lord, There are a few things that we can learn from this passage. How do we apply it to our lives? What's the point? It's great that Paul spoke this to the church of Corinth, but how does this apply to us? Well, first, remember that Paul, he's continually writing about division. This is just one of the errors that divided the church. They're divided by who they followed, Apollos or Peter or Paul or Jesus. And Paul says, that's ridiculous. The church is united. And here the idea of wisdom was dividing the church. As a church, we need to be firm and united in what we believe about God. We need to stand up together. Earlier in the passage, he tells them, I urge you, brothers, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, that you all say the same thing, that there be no divisions among you, and that you be united with the same understanding and the same conviction. We have to guard against division in the church. I'm not saying we're all robots or brainwashed, but I am saying we need to be united in a purpose as we honor God. But secondly, we as a church need to stop acting like, well, you can either choose sides or you can follow God. Sometimes that's how we come across. We accept the war on science. We say, well, you might believe that science, though, but I believe the Bible. That's not the way it works. God who created the world, for those of you who helped with Vacation Bible School, one of the main mottos was, God created the world and the laws that govern the world. When we learn about the world, we learn about God. It is his testimony. Outside of the Bible, it's the greatest testimony that God has left is the world around us. And the more we study it, the more we learn about it, the more we understand who he is. As we go to this time of invitation, I don't know how God's dealing with you. Honestly, my main concern with this passage, it's not an evangelistic message. It's not trying to see if we can get baptisms. It's not any of that kind of stuff. Honestly, what I want us as Christians to do is to be willing to think, to understand what role philosophy and thought plays in our minds, plays in our faith. To be willing to examine this and understand that what the world considers as wisdom, it's not wisdom. It's foolishness. God has given us true wisdom as the perfect plan that comes through his son, Jesus Christ. But maybe you haven't had that relationship with God. Maybe science is something that has been keeping you from your relationship with God. Maybe you've bought into the Dawkins Mayer argument. This is how we come forward and understand that to accept Christ, it doesn't make you stupid. It doesn't make you an idiot. It doesn't make you mean you reject science. It means that you embrace it. He exists and he loves you so much that he did the craziest thing imaginable. He sent his son to die on the cross for you. I hope that if you don't have that relationship with him, that this morning you will. Maybe you want to come forward and you just have this sin in your life that you're struggling with. Maybe you just need prayer. Maybe you're interested in baptism. This time the altar is open for you. You can come forward, you can kneel and pray, you can kneel at the steps, you can talk to me, or you can stay at your seat and just pray to God. But I hope that whatever happens, that you do business with God this morning. Whatever he's calling you to do, my prayer is that you'll go at it with all of your heart and surrender yourself to him. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, thank you for this time that you've given to us. We thank you that you are an awesome God. We thank you that you've shown that you exist, that you have not left us without evidence. You don't call us to blindly follow you because we're supposed to, or because our parents did, or for whatever reason. That you've proven that you exist. You have revealed yourself through the world around us, Father. And I pray that we wouldn't be deceived when we hear people who argue against that, who think that they can use science to discredit you. Lord, I pray for this church that you would clear us from any division. You help us to be united in purpose as we honor you and as we follow you. Continue to use us for your purposes and for your glory. Lord, I pray that you will help us to come before you, to examine what you've done. That we wouldn't just be ignorant, Father, but that we would represent you to the world around us. And many people have questions about you, and many of them are valid questions, Father. I pray that you'll help us to take them seriously and be prepared to answer them. We love you, Lord. Thank you for this church. Thank you for everybody here. Pray that you would continue to live in this place. We ask all of this in Jesus' precious and holy name.